Every dream is born from a passion. Every passion generates a mission. Every mission merits perpetuation. We understand this process linkage. Created solutions for financial stability and management. Built a company for your dream's fulfillment. Spring Rain Global Consultancy Incorporated. Like rain during springtime, we nourish your dream that it be filled with life. We evaluate your financial capacity at the starting line. We improve your financial literacy over time. We generate your financial blueprint along the way. Help improve projects that are underway. Develop new strategies for financial balance to be attained. Find you, philanthropic partners, who wish your mission be generously sustained. Spring Rain Global Consultancy Incorporated. Nourishing your dreams into fruition and regeneration.
A PDO is a philanthropic development office. We consider as the basic unit of the ecosystem where we professionalize the direct linkage between donors and beneficiaries. It will institutionalize and create transparency, good stewardship of resources, monitor impact of their programs, create advocacy impact so that in the holistic part of it, it's not just only about the money, but it's also the stewardship of the utilization of this money that is supporting the mission of these charities. We are also trying to build an ecosystem of different philanthropic development offices because it is only in the ecosystem that we will be able to sustain our growth together.
We see that this PDO thing, this whole ecosystem, social commerce, and crypto philanthropy is the best way forward towards sustainability. Not only for the foundation itself, but also for the beneficiaries who eventually be the ones to receive whatever benefits that the foundation will be receiving. And of course, ultimately, the other PDOs also all over the country.
It has helped us to identify our funding needs, especially for the sick, with the help and guidance that they are giving. Our ministry to the sick is now more organized, more efficient, and systematic.
They have been doing their best to assist us and to work from where we are so that we could truly function as such.
One thing that Spring Rain was able to help us and has been going on until now is really connecting a lot of people, and not only here in the Philippines, but also in abroad.
They have given us the right mindset, the skill set, and the tool set that we need in order to establish our office and to raise funds for our apostolate in education.
It was very chaotic before Spring Rain. We were just scrambling and trying to figure things out. Where Spring Rain came and gave us the technology on how to run it properly. We had departments, roles, and it was an organized machine where it's just like a business or any entity that it would function on its own. Even if one person's not there or the president is not there, the foundation is constantly moving and functioning.
For the new PDOs, the resources that you have will be maximized because of the system that Spring Rain will teach you and will share with you.
The system has helped us how to pool resources, how to manage the fund, how also to manage our advocacies, our activities and program, how to sustain it, and plans are being done for its continuity.
I would like to invite you to engage with Spring Rain and help the people, your community, more with the system.
Without the system, it will block succession. If you have the right skillful people without the system, then it cannot sustain long enough. If you have a system without the right people, then you miss the opportunity of maximizing the whole process. There's a lot of donor fatigue that is happening right now. And it's not because they don't want to give. It's about being annoyed by the manner of asking. It's actually the manner of the way we are communicating with the donor.
The perennial problem that we have been encountering is the problem of sustainability. Partly because we haven't nourished and nurtured relationships with our different benefactors all these years. That's when I see the great potential that once we are able to connect and to nurture our relationship with our donors and eventually make their donation, make their giving more of a happy experience, then probably things will be better. So that it doesn't become a linear type of relationship, but it becomes a mutual kind of relationship. When the donor gives, he is happy because he was able to give, and of course he is happy that he is being regularly updated by the happenings and the updates of the foundation itself.
We are able to see more people who are really not only business driven, but deep inside they want to make their businesses even more meaningful. They are finding meaning on giving impact to the lives of others. It ignites more our desire to do mission, to expand our mission. We are very excited to continue doing it and to be more serious about it.
It takes a way to really study them and learn about how these donors need to get motivated, get involved, so that the fatigue that is happening will turn into a transformation of partnership, love, generosity, and it will create a very wonderful for family in the world of philanthropy.
There goes my heart. Please come back now.
There goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing.
Good evening, everyone, and also good morning and good afternoon to those who are joining us from other parts of the world via Facebook Live. Welcome to the 32nd day of Spring Rain Global's 45 Days Lenten Recollection, a Lenten journey of faith in the life of the saints. We are live every day for the next days of this Lenten journey via Zoom and on the Facebook page of Spring Rain Global. To ensure the solemnity of our recollection, may I request everyone to please keep your microphones on mute as soon as you log in and for the whole duration of the program. Let us now begin with our opening song, followed by the Spring Rain Global prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Sweet to others' love. The Spring Rain Global Prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be called in this noble endeavor of serving people and organizations through our thrust for a deeper love for humanity and stewardship of our giftedness. As we respond to this ministry each day, fill us with the power of the Holy Spirit, that your wisdom may enlighten us, that your strength may remind us to stay focused in our purpose and calling, that your light be our guide at all times, and that your love be in our hearts. We know that the journey may not always be easy, but we firmly believe and hold on to your promise that you will be with us both in our challenges and victories as we bring love and unity to your people in service for others. We continue to pray that as we grow the mission and purpose of our Spring Rain Global family, we may be sustained by your grace, ready to open the path for others, so that your blessings and divine providence may completely flow to each and every one of us. May we always stay in your grace, now and forever. This we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Play the national anthems of the Philippines, U.S., and Singapore to signify the countries where Spring Rain Global is registered and operating.
Bayang magigil, keras ng silanganan, alam ng puso sa dibdib mo'y buhay. Lupang hinirang, tuyan ka ng magiting sa manlulubing. Di ka pa sisiin sa dagat at punong, sa simoy at sa langit mong bukaw. May dilag ang tula at awit sa paglayang minamahal. Ang isap ng watawag mo'y tagumpay na nanginuning. Ang bituin ng araw niya kailan pamay ni madidiling. Panang araw ng wal, habang pansin ka, buhay ay langit sa amin mo. Aming ligaya na pag may mga ating ang mamatay ng dahil sa'yo.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright star through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Or say just that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the brave. Mari kita rakyat Singapura sama-sama menuju bahagia. Cita-cita kita yang mulia, berjaya Singapura. Marilah kita bersatu dengan semangat yang baru. Semua kita berseru, majulah Singapura, majulah Singapura. Marilah kita bersatu dengan semangat yang baru. Semua kita berseru, majulah Singapura, majulah Singapura.
Again, welcome to the 32nd day of Spring Rain Global's 45 Days Lenten Recollection, a Lenten journey of faith in the life of the saint. Tonight's reflection is about the journey of faith of life of Saint Maria Gorete, and we will be guided in our reflection by Miss Esther Claire Dawn, nurse and medical technologist, Community Healthcare System. Let us all welcome Miss Esther.
Hello, everyone. My name is Esther, and welcome to another day of our Lenten journey. I will be joining you as I share my reflection on today's saint, Saint Maria Gorete, or lovingly known to her family as Marietta. I would like to thank Father Victor and the SRG team for this opportunity. I am truly humbled because as I was reading about Saint Maria Gorete, I realized that age does not determine our faith and our holiness. We can be living witnesses, true Christians, right where we are, as old as we are, in our own places in time. The Lord calls us to do incredible things, and Maria Gorete is one of those stories. Let me now share my screen. Are you able to see it?
Yes, miss.
Thank you. Saint Maria Gorete, or the little saint of great mercy. Great mercy, such big words for a little girl. When we think of mercy, we think of forgiveness, compassion. And in this picture, we see Maria with white lily, with a white lily. And as we learn her story today, we will find out the significance of this white lily. As I was reflecting on the life of Maria Gorete, I had to ask myself how someone so young can become a saint. And it dawned on me that Maria Gorete did two extraordinary things. One, she lived a life of faith as seen in her prayer life and in her devotion to the Holy Eucharist. And two, she forgave her murderer, the one who attempted to rape her. So Maria Gorete was also known as the patroness of youth, young women, purity, forgiveness, and victims of rape. This is Maria with her mother and Maria with her siblings. Maria Gorete, or Marietta, as she was lovingly called, was born in Corinaldo, Italy in 1890. When Maria was born, she was named after and consecrated to the Blessed Mother. She was a third of six children. Her father, Luigi, owned a farm, and along with her mother, Assunta, took care of their children. Her family was very poor, and life was hard. Because of their poverty in 1897, her family looked for work in Lazio region, where they shared a house with the Serinellis, Father Giovanni, and son Alessandro. When Maria turned nine, her father died of malaria, which made their lives even harder. While her other brothers and sisters worked in the farm with their mother, Maria did the household chores. Through all their struggles, the Goretti maintained a deep faith in God, which strengthened their family bond. Maria never went to school and could not read nor write. Around the age of 11, she attended catechism to prepare for her first Holy Communion. One day, while she was sitting on the stairs mending a shirt, Alessandro attempted to rape her. She begged him to stop while saying, "No, God does not wish it. It is a sin. You will go to hell for it." As Maria fought off his advances, Alessandro became angry and stabbed Maria 14 times. Maria was taken to the hospital. Doctors tried hard to save her life. Before death, Maria asked for the Viaticum, or the Last Sacrament as we know it. Just imagine a girl of 11 years old fighting for her life, still longing for Jesus in the Holy Eucharist. Just see her love and faith in Jesus. After 20 painful hours of suffering, Maria died with her last gaze upon the Blessed Virgin. Her final recorded words were, "I forgive Alessandro Serinelli, and I want him with me in heaven." How about us? If we were Maria Goretti, would we still forgive our killer? Would we still forgive our attempted rapist? So what do you think happened to Alessandro? Did he ask for forgiveness from Maria's family? Was he even sorry for his crime? Alessandro was never sorry. He was arrested for his crime. Police found a great deal of pornography in his residence. He was sentenced to 30 years in prison. For many years, he only grew more bitter. In other words, Alessandro never tried to change. One night, Alessandro had a vision. Maria handed him white lilies in a garden. He accepted them, and each one turned into a white flame. When he awoke, he confessed his sins to a local bishop. And that is why images of Maria Goretti show her with white lilies. It is because of this miraculous vision. Now, this is a picture of Maria's mother, Assunta, and Alessandro. Alessandro sends Maria's forgiveness, and this changed him. He was released from prison 3 years early, and the first thing he did was to visit Maria's mother and beg for his forgiveness. He later became a lay brother in a Capuchin monastery. This is how the conversion of Alessandro happened. This is what forgiveness can do. Maria Goretti was beatified in 1947 and canonized by Pope Pius XII in 1950. Having died at the age of 11, she was the youngest canonized saint in the Catholic Church's long history. And on this slide, we even see Assunta, Maria's mother, and she was there because this was the first time that a parent was present for a child's canonization. And as you can see, many attended, over 500,000. This was the largest of any canonization up to that point in time. It was moved from St. Peter's Basilica to St. Peter's Square, being the first open-air canonization in history. Her feast day is July 6th, the day that she died. After knowing the sad but beautiful story of Maria Goretti, it got me thinking, what were the virtues of Maria that truly made an impact? There are love for God, which were manifested through her purity and her faith, humility, and forgiveness. Love for God. In our lives, what does loving someone mean? Think of the people that are most special to you. Your husband, your wife, your kids, your best friend, your brother or sister in the community, your significant other. Isn't it that we try to make the people we love happy? Isn't it that we try to please the person we love? Do we choose to be committed even when circumstances are tough? What does loving God mean? It is knowing God, worshiping Him, and serving Him alone. When we love God, we want to please Him and obey His commands. Maria Goretti loved God so much that she was committed to her purity and her faith. She chose death rather than participate in a sin against God. When she was about to get raped, she cried out to Alessandro, "No, God does not wish it. It is a sin." She did this not just to protect herself, but also to protect Alessandro because she knew that it was a mortal sin. Maria chose to remain pure because of her love for God. Nowadays, there is a big challenge to preserve purity. There are a lot of things on social media that are lustful. Some are addicted to pornography. Others practice premarital sex. What makes us unclean are also the words that we say and the things that we do that do not come from love. We can start with ourselves. Our thoughts, our words, our conversations, the shows that we watch, the things that we follow on Facebook, Instagram, the people that we admire. Are any of these inappropriate, impure, or embarrassing? Are any of these rude or shameful? From an early age, Maria had so much faith in God. She knew the teachings of the church and fully obeyed it. She and her family prayed the rosary every day. Before her death, she even asked for the body of Christ. And this is what Maria said about the Eucharist. The Holy Eucharist is the perfect expression of the love of Jesus Christ for men. Humility. This is a picture of Maria's home in Coronado, Italy, and this is Maria in the farm. When we think of childhood, we think of happiness, playgrounds, parks, toys, music. Parents try their hardest to give children whatever they want or need for them to be happy, healthy, and safe. Maria's childhood was very different. The lack of toys and schooling never bothered Maria, who enjoyed the gift of life and lived in the present moment. Maria took on the tasks of her mother while watching her younger sibling. Yet, she did not complain. She was even well known to her neighbors for her joy and piety. It is hard to imagine youngsters nowadays take on adult responsibilities, let alone do so with cheerfulness. Humility is knowing that God is above all things. It is the awareness that everything we own and everything we do is a gift from God. To practice humility, we need to be grateful for what we have and not take things for granted. How do we practice joy in moments of hardship? How can acceptance of doing simple tasks lead to love and holiness? Do you see hardships as an opportunity to share in Christ's sufferings? And lastly, but the most powerful virtue that Maria Goretti had is forgiveness. On her deathbed, Maria did the most saintly thing. She forgave her attacker and also wanted him to be with her in heaven. Isn't that an absolutely beautiful thing, but also challenging to do? What kind of awesome, divine, grace-filled response to evil is that? That is what our world needs right now. So many people are angry, and we have a lack of forgiveness. Sometimes we don't want to forgive an unfaithful partner. It is hard to forgive a friend who betrays us. We also get irritated when someone borrows money and then when it's time to pay up, doesn't respond to our text messages. And sometimes I even get hurt when someone tells me, "Oh, Easter, you look tired. Oh, looks like you gained weight." But look at Maria Goretti. This little girl showed us what it meant to love, and what it meant to forgive. In the gospel, Jesus even tells us something about forgiveness. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, "I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. How often do we forgive? It is not the number, but Jesus wants us to live a continual process of forgiveness. Every day and always, we should be ready to forgive. Little things and big things. Jesus taught us by his example. While Jesus was being crucified at his darkest hour, his prayer still focused on forgiveness for the lost. Jesus' example on the cross allows no room to keep grudges. And Saint Maria Goretti, who also followed Jesus while hanging up on the cross, on her deathbed, she forgave her murderer with the words, "I too wish him to join me in paradise. Yes, Christ is asking us to forgive, but it is hard. Can we really forgive and forget? Can we forgive and trust again? The feeling of distrust is normal, and sometimes we could not forget the hurt. Forgiveness doesn't mean, though, that we need to be best friends again. It doesn't mean that because I forgive you, we can go to Starbucks together. As they say, forgive quickly and trust slowly. Forgiveness means I am surrendering the pain to God. Forgiveness is liberating and life-changing. As we are approaching the last few weeks of Lent and reflecting on the lives of these saints, we remind ourselves that God has good things for us to do in our life. We are not saved by doing good, but we are saved in order to do good. God has a purpose and plan for us. In closing, let us take a few moments to reflect on these questions.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let us all together pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Saint Maria Goretti, help us to become like you. Through your powerful intercession, grant us the grace to persevere in our faith and to walk constantly in his presence. Help us to choose purity over earthly gain. Heal our hurts and give us the courage to forgive, to follow Christ as you have done. Grant us the grace to accept that when we are wounded, we are offered the beautiful opportunity to share in Christ's sufferings. Amen.
Thank you, Miss Easter, for guiding us in our reflection tonight. Saint Maria had been taught by her parents the catechism, and her beautiful soul had been educated to be aware that Christians belong to God totally, body and soul. Saint Maria's story reminds us of the power of a firm resolve. True, but her resolve did not come about from a simple one-time decision. She lived out her decision every day and constantly renewed her love for Jesus in small sacrifices. Her story reminds us that true happiness demands courage and a spirit of sacrifice, refusing every compromise with evil and having the disposition to pay personally, even with death, faithful to God and his commandments. Today, pleasure, selfishness, and directly immoral actions are often exalted in the name of false ideals of liberty and happiness. It is essential to reaffirm clearly that purity of heart and of body go together, because chastity is the custodian of authentic love. Thank you, everyone, for joining us this evening. To continue our spiritual growth this Lent and beyond, a group chat was created for all the participants of Spring Rain Global's 45-day Lenten recollection. Inclusion and participation in the group chat will be voluntary. Before we move on to the closing part of our recollection for tonight, may we please request everybody to turn on their cameras for our picture taking.
Hello, good evening po everyone. Am I audible po, miss?
Yes, Ed. Okay.
Good evening po everyone. Requesting everyone po to please turn on their cameras so that we can capture our beautiful and handsome smiles. Okay, and please also hold your smiles po, kasi this is two slides po. Okay, on my count po, in 3, 2, 1, smile. Okay, for a second po. Okay, second slide po. Hold your smiles. In 3, 2, 1. Okay, thank you very much po.
Thank you, everyone. Please join us again tomorrow, 8 p.m. Philippine time, here at Zoom or live via the Spring Rain Global Facebook page for the 33rd day of Spring Rain Global's 45 days Lenten recollection, a Lenten journey of faith in the life of the saints. Tomorrow's topic is a Lenten journey of faith in the life of Saint Rita of Kasha, and we will be led in our reflection by Miss Daisy E. Perez, Internal Auditor, University of San Agustin. We hope that you will invite your family and friends, and together let us nurture our faith, love, and devotion to the Lord. As we play our closing song, we bid good night to everybody watching from the Philippines and good day to all those watching from other parts of the world. Thank you and see you tomorrow. May God bless us all.
Say to the Lord, my refuge. not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up.
Everyone, see you tomorrow.